Amen. Good to be home. Me and Toby, we had a little bit of a discussion the other day. I called her up. So about, I'm from San Diego, girls. I said, no, you ain't. You're from Tulare. How long were you in San Diego? So we had to kind of do the math on that, right? About half my life here. And she said, man, when that dude asked me where you were from at Time Out Pizza, you told him, I'm from right here. I'm from Tulare. I said, that's wisdom. That's wisdom. Nah. This is home though. It's been home. It's been home. It's good to have my sister-in-law Stephanie in the house of God with us this morning. Amen. If you got your Bibles with me or this morning, turn to Psalms 16. Let's see here. Let me go ahead and get there real quick. I was inspired with this message last week, and it just all kind of came into play, but I think it's important. You can't ever take the word of God as being soft, as being not true, right? You have to take the word of God as life, direction for your life, strengthening of your life, amen? It's more than just a book. Let's go ahead and get into it. Psalms 16, verse 1. The Bible reads like this. Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I said to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing. As for the saints who are in the land, they are the glorious ones in whom all my delight. The sorrows of those who increase, who run after other gods, I will not pour out their lamentations of blood, or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made me my lot secure. You have made my lot secure. Excuse me. The boundary lines have fallen for me in a pleasant place. Surely I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me even at night. My heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is my right hand, and I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body will also rest secure. Because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with your joy and your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Praise God, right? How many know that there's nothing like despair, anger, hurt, sorrow, grief, or the need for acceptance that will cause somebody to examine what's the meaning of life? In this portion of scripture, this is what David was experiencing. Who's experiencing it. I was reading the commentators on this, and what's going on right here is David was being tracked down by King Saul, right? He wanted to put an end to him. He wanted to take him out. He wanted to kill him. And this caused David to flee to the woodsy hills, to the forest, right? With 400 of his men. Well, they were still outnumbered by 2,600 because King Saul had 3,000 men. He was the king of Israel. It was during this time that David and one of his men went on a mission. Check this out. Who's brave enough? We're going to go into Saul's camp, and I'm going to prove a point. So him and this individual, they went, snuck into the camp, I'm thinking he might have some hogs around him because nobody woke up. But the Bible says it is God that kept him asleep, right? They took his water jug and his spear that was by his head, one of the most vital parts of the body, right? And on the next morning, David goes on into the valley on the other side, and he starts calling out names. you're the leader of Saul's army, and you guys were lacking. You guys were slipping. You guys weren't protecting the king. That could be punishable with death, right? So Saul's hearing all this, and he comes out and he says, David, is that you? And he says, yes, O Lord, it is me. Right? Let's see here. David right away got into the fact of, okay, so now I have your attention. Why are you chasing me? What wrong have I done to you? What caused you to be angry with me to the point of my death? Why have I been forced out of my land and been told to worship other gods? Why? What have I done to you but be loyal? Be under you. Being a servant of God, and you want to kill me for what? It's not fair. You can read about that in 1 Samuel chapter 26. But can you handle that? David did nothing wrong. Nothing wrong. Giant needed to be slain, took care of business. Saul needed this or needed that, he took care of business. David started getting a little bit of praise. Jealousy took in, right? What did David really do to deserve it? Man? He honored Saul. They wanted to whack Saul. He says, no, man, you shall not touch God's anointed. How many know that if we get offended or we get pressed on, sometimes we want to, you know? Can you handle that though? Can you imagine the hurt and confusion that was going on in the heart of David? Like, you want to kill me, man? You got 3,000 men seeking my life? When I would have been the best thing to you. Right? Let's talk about us. God. Why? I don't understand this. Why is this happening? I'm faithful. I don't get it. This makes no sense. Is this you, God? Like, okay, get me somewhere here. Need some water. Spirit for cotton mouth. Full fat. Excuse me. What do I do? What did I do to deserve this, God? Praise God. It's during this time that commentators are saying that David wrote Psalm 16. Okay? How many know that we've all been in those situations where it just didn't make sense? Like, how is this even so? This is, it ain't fair. Maybe not to the point of you got somebody want to take your life, but wait a minute. What does the Bible say? That the devil is out to see who we can devour, kill, steal, and destroy. But we sleep on that. We sleep on that. Me? I've slept on it. I've made more mistakes in my Christian walk than I would ever like to admit. You understand that? Like, because you can't get lax in this thing. You can't. We need to understand that there is no one that is exempt from hell coming at them. Nobody. Not even Jesus. We remember what happened in the Garden of Gethsemane. We understand that it had to happen, right? But the vessels were of evil. Right? We understand that there had to be an atonement for our sin. We understand. But even that broke Jesus. Man, what did he say? I'm going to go and pray. God, is there any way this can pass from me? Is there any way? Like, this is too much. I can't bear this. And I never really caught this, right? But you have brothers that are closed off. They don't want to open up to their pastors, right? I always encourage you, man. Pastor don't want to know your business, but he wants to help you. And he's raised up me, Silas. We've given him everything under the book. No, I say that, you know, joking. He's got experience, right? But what does Jesus say in the prior scripture? My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow. He's telling the disciples, man, I'm tripping. My soul is crushed with grief, consumed with sorrow. We're talking about the Son of God, right? He was going through it. He was absolutely going through it. And I know that there's a... If we were in the same place and we were going to be sacrificed, our worries and our sorrow would probably be a little more deeper or less deeper than Jesus's. He was sad because he's going to be separated from God for 3 days. They don't want that. And then there's a whole lot of other issues going on. Saying that to say this, don't ever judge the severity of somebody's problem based on your opinion. Because you will lose that man. You will lose that sister. Take it seriously. Man. I'm just trying to paint a picture here and give you an understanding of hardships and trials and tribulations, attacks. We'll all come to that place to where we ask God, like, I can't do this. I don't know how. I don't understand. Why me? We get selfish real quick. Why me? How come not that person? Listen to me today, church. We've all been there. Right? You've been there? Am I the only one?
No.
But how many in this place this morning have made this comment before? In the thick of it. I give up. Let's do it. I give up. Life is. This ain't worth living. Life ain't worth living for what? All this? I'm done. I'm done. I can't handle this any longer. I am done. It's an attack on your life, church. I was going to ask. I asked my sister-in-law, my wife yesterday. Have you ever got those thoughts in your head? You know what I mean? I'm not saying being suicidal and all that, but just like, I'm done. I'd rather be with you, God. Like Jonah says, God, can't you just take me? Can't you just take me? They're going through it back then. But has that ever came into this? And I hope that you rebuked it. But that they had to get there. There's a war, church.
That's right.
There's a war. He can't get you on drugs. He can't get you on this. He can't get you on that. He can't get you on the next one anymore. Coming differently. Do not underestimate the devil and his works. Understand, in the right lane of action, he can't touch you. But he doesn't stop. He doesn't stop. God is reckless, the devil is relentless. but we are victorious.
Yeah.
Right? There's people all over the world, people that we may even know in here. They weren't able to overcome that. That's why suicide rate is through the roof. It broke them down so much. Life ain't worth living for what? Torment? Persecution? Confusion? You have to know your enemy. You have to know him. And you have to recognize him. You ever been around somebody and you're like, I remember Pastor Eddie told me this. When somebody's on a good one and they start snapping their fingers and that little ankle's going, oh, you fly. What it is your spirit bears witness with that spirit. You know that spirit, familiar, you know. That's of the devil right there. Many have ended their own lives because it was just too much to bear. Spiritual suicide, physical suicide. It's an absolute battle. It's more than a battle, it's a war going on inside of your mind, your heart, my heart. Seems that nowadays everybody wants to try to fill that void or that emptiness with everything but God. Right? You know, the other night, was at Santa Barbara with my boss, and he's kind of a picky dude. Like, he doesn't like the, he's a plain guy. So he's like, hey, let's stop and grab something to eat. So we went into like the college area of Santa Barbara. It was like 10:20 at night. I was still in the doghouse for that one. But all these college kids were still out. I'm like, do they have classes this night? You know we ended up, because if everybody out like this, cops are pulling everybody over. You know what I mean? Like, so you know, we're right there talking, and he goes, dude, like, I actually had a friend who came to this college, and he had a roommate by the name of Elliot Rogers. And I was like, okay. And he goes, man, he goes, you never heard about that shooting that happened here? I said, nah. He goes, look it up. Basically, what it was is this dude was from London. Mom and dad divorced. Dad moved to LA. Got money, sent him, you know, to Santa Barbara. And I'm a cool kid. But there were some things going on inside of him that were just fermenting and developing, right? The dude was really struggling with the fact that, man, I'm 22 and I'm still a virgin. I haven't been with a woman yet. Why do all these brutes, these jocks, these baseball players, they got all these women? And he talks like, I'm a supreme gentleman type thing, right? Like it's kind of crazy. But it broke my heart for this man. He said, I don't understand. It's not fair. I'm lonely. Right? So I looked at another video and I'm tripping out. I'm like, man. He's going into the woods and he goes, well, here I am again by myself. I'm tired of being lonely. Another video. I hate women. I will kill them. I'm going to go into the sorority with all the little blonde hair, blue eyed girls, and I'm going to take care of business. He had some issues going on. But that void could have been filled. But he's seeking attention from everybody else. So his plan came into play. He killed 6 people and then he killed himself. He allowed that to consume his every being of his life. To where there was no other remedy. There was nothing else that could. Women, you don't want me, I'm going to make you pay for it. Good looking dude. I mean, man, he could have just like chill out a little bit on the vocabulary or something. I don't know. We should have brought him to the hood. But it broke my heart because this dude was struggling. And the whole time, I could guarantee you, let me in, man. Hey, Elliot, let me in. I can fix you. Come on. I got you. We all know the answer is Jesus. And it remains the same over and over and over and over and over and over again. It's got to be Jesus. Life don't stop. Time don't stop. The enemies don't stop. And for sure, God don't stop. But we stop. We stop going to God. Speaking on personal experiences, David, in the midst of his chaos, being pursued, did what all mankind should do. He went and got before God. When the devil starts whispering in your life, your life ain't worth living. That's when you gotta tell that no good lying snake, oh, check it out. My life is worth living. Because I know I have a friend in Jesus. Right? What does verse 1 say? Keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. I take refuge in you. You got me. Understand it. This is the only way understand that we could always continually go to God. God is not going to judge you. You might deal with the same situation over and over and over again. But let me tell you what, if you're here today, right? You're on top. You're on top. Okay? So we understand that life is worth living because we have a friend in Jesus and we can always look unto him for help. Amen? Second point here. Trust and believe that God will never abandon you. God will never abandon you. Well, I don't hear him. Well, have you picked up the book? Have you? COVID tore me up, man. Being so accustomed to being in this place multiple times a week. Right? I learned something. Yeah, you thought you were spiritually bad. You're just a little boy. What are you going to do when all that's gone? I had to buck up. Thank God for a wife that's like, man up, dude. Man up. What's cool with that? You don't even call him anyway. Is that what I got to do for you to call him? See, I thought I arrived. I thought I had it. Right? I thought, hey, I'm good. Chopping the old lady down. Being disrespectful. Being in the flesh. Letting my head get to me. Fear. Thinking I'm going to bring home COVID to the wife. And, you know, just nonsense. And what was happening is I was just emptying out every ounce of God that I had into me. You're going to run off your own fuels at that time. I mean, don't get me wrong, like, I know enough, like, man, God, I got to put you back first. I got to, you know what I mean? I got to, not that I didn't keep him first, but I was just making bad choices, like, just acting crazy, you know? I abandoned God. He didn't abandon me. It's the famous thing. God's cruising. You got the long seat, right? Right here by him. I said, man, God, why are you way over there? Steering wheel don't move. You moved. Okay? Life is worth living when you understand that you are not alone and that you're a part of a huge family. A huge family. Right? You have access You have people that are willing to fight on their knees with you. Lack and Lodom believe God for you. Those who love God and love us are all around. We might be few, but we're crazy. The church is important, but it's the relationship. The relationship. That's just a byproduct of having a relationship with God. Because, like, the church wasn't always there, right? Church wasn't always there. But guess what? You could have picked up the phone. Hey, brother, I'm going through this right now. You could have called your pastor. Those of the same mindset, operating in one mind and one accord, locked in battle, side by side. Leo, remember we used to go to the jail? Shadrach and Meshach, here we come. Watch out now. We were on a mission. We're going into the devil's playground. It's a blessing right there. Right? Being involved in the things of God will help. Focusing on our inheritance will give you peace. Understand what has been done for you. Understand that there's been a price that has been paid. Take notice of that. I'm only here for a second. Place value in what Christ did for us in order for us to receive our inheritance. Guard your salvation because that price has been paid. I don't know if I said this about the gypsies and what they do. Real story. Guy came in, I'm drawing up a contract. He gets a phone call. Oh man, they pull my son over in the Ashland parking lot. I gotta run over there real quick, but I'll be right back. So he goes back, sure enough, they pull him over and he's like, yeah, they're all crazy. Him and his wife and all that. He goes, she cost me too much money. I said, what? Like, what? He goes, yeah, man, I had to buy her. $10,000. But why do they do that? You wanna take care of 10 G's. You gonna make that work, son. She ain't leaving. You gotta make it work. There's a value on it, right? True story. So when salvation has been brought to us by the redeeming blood of Jesus, that price has been paid. You have to try your hardest. You have to just do it. If you fall, get back up. Nah. Jesus, you going through that for me? I'm not gonna sin. Amen? In this life, it's worth living because we have an inheritance. Like I just told you, there's a life after death for believers and for non-believers. Okay? Life is worth living. What do I see here? We talked about when you have a friend in Jesus, but it could be much more than that. Intimacy with God. Life is worth living when you not only have a friendship with Jesus, but you have a close relationship with God. Verse 8. I have set the Lord always before me because he is at my right hand. I will not be shaken. Set God before you. But in order to do that, you got to get up daily. And you got to put him there. You got to give him that right of way in your life. Understand. Right? Praise God. The result of a close relationship with God will be the security, the empowerment, and access to the throne room of grace. The veil has been torn, church. We have access. We have access to the Spirit of God. We have access to be brought where God wants us, for His Spirit to be upon us. Life is worth living When you remember the faithfulness of God, verses 9 through 11, therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let the Holy One see decay. You have made known unto me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Praise God. We can rejoice knowing that we are not just wandering through this timeline, but we have purpose. We have meaning. We can be filled with the joy of the Lord just by doing what David did. When you're going through it, lean on these. I have a friend of Jesus. He's faithful. Man, I got a close relationship with God. Close. Right? He's gonna show up. So you keep on egging me on, devil. Don't try to do it by yourself. Because once you say, I got this, you've already lost. Right. We can know the comfort of God's presence by just asking and knowing that it'll be there. We can be assured of eternal pleasures because of Him and His love for us. Is life worth living? Absolutely. As long as it is in Christ. Now, if you're to talk to somebody who doesn't believe in God, I'm good. 200 rack a year. Life got a little, you know, Range Rover. I'm driving a nice Range Rover. I got no worries. Remember, though, there's a hereafter. There's a hereafter. Two different destinations. The wide road, the narrow road. It's completely up to us to choose, though. And we have to make that choice while we're here on earth. It's completely up to us to maintain and work out our own salvation with fear, with respect, and trembling. And understand that a life without Christ is a life that is never fixed to the ones who battle with doubt. What does the Bible say? That no man gets to me except through the Father. Right? Regardless of your accomplishment, if it's done in the secular, it's done in the secular. Just because we live in a fallen world, and we might go through hell, right? It doesn't mean that we can't have a life worth living in Jesus. If you just understand that, hey, it's gonna come, it's gonna happen. I need to be prepared. I've been knocked off my horse. I've been put right back on the road to Damascus, humbled. I wanna go back like that, you know? I don't want to question God. I want to lean on God. Do you get annoyed when your kids start asking you questions? Like, well, my son's older, you know what I'm saying? Like, but if my nieces or any of my nephews, they question their mom and dad, I tell them, like, come on, boy, you're an adult. What are you questioning them for? No. Right? Don't question God. Understand that it's going to happen. You're not exempt from it. Trials and tribulations are going to take place. I was speaking to a woman, and she was telling me that her husband got real ill, and they thought that they might lose him. And she told me something that just blew me away. She said, I was all right with it, though. I was at peace. Like, what? At peace. Why though? Why do you think she was at peace? Because she had that friend in Jesus with a close relationship and leaned on His faithfulness. It's a life worth living. What can get you down? With all that being applied, your understanding will be through the roof. And then what, church? And then you're able to help the next person going through that. Remember the large family. Remember the large family. Don't be afraid to ask a brother if he looks down. Hey, bro, you good? Like, sometimes that's all they want to be asked. You know? And then they come out. You just never know. That's all I got this morning, church.